Okay, then let's continue. So the crucial thing is this variational, is the log model evidence decomposition into the variational free energy and the Kell divergence. Briefly about the term free energy, don't try to think of it in any form of physical energy, whatever that is. Physicists don't know what energy is. Nobody knows what energy is. And don't even try to think about what free energy means. You can look into thermodynamics, that's interesting, and there you will come across things that are called free energy and entropy and energy, and this is all interesting. Here it's called free energy mainly because of historical reasons and because of some parallels in the equations to thermodynamic equations. But the whole thing doesn't have any thermodynamic or any physical meaning. This is purely, what we are talking about are purely probabilistic models, so statistical models. And it's just a quantity, a function that we can work with. And I really recommend for yourself to call it ELBO, so evidence lower bound, because that's kind of more meaningful. But the community, specifically our community, calls it free energy, so you should also know this term, of course. And I think I call it free energy a lot. But yeah, try to, for yourself, for your own mental health, don't try to understand why free energy and what it has to do with energy or something being free. Yeah? Just don't. You can do it, then you will go crazy at one point, and then you will say, well, I was told not to go down this way, so maybe I now go back and call it ELBO. But yeah. Of course, it's also called free energy in the free energy world of cognitive neuroscience because it's nicely mysterious, because it's like free energy. If it would think about it, the free energy principle would be called ELBO principle or evidence lower bound principle. Then everybody would say, oh, okay, let's look what this is. But if it's called free energy and you have no idea about what's going on, then of course it sounds a lot better. And it's like unicorn energy or something like that. Okay, now let's look into the intuition of that. And mainly let's do that with figures. So this bar here, yeah, so you see this bar, like a Mars bar. Or Twix bar, or whatever. This is supposed to represent the log marginal likelihood. Yeah. So think of it like a physical bar, something like this. This is the marginal likelihood. It has a specific extent in terms of space. If you make it, if it's longer, so something like this, then the log marginal likelihood is larger, and if it's like this, the log marginal likelihood is a little bit smaller. The thing is, for a given probabilistic model, the log marginal likelihood and for a given probabilistic model and a given data point, the log marginal likelihood is a fixed number. Yeah. So if you, for this y here, submit a specific, for example, in the GLM, a specific data vector, then the log marginal likelihood is one number. Yeah, that's something like, I don't know, usually these are, it's often negative because these values are quite small, so it's something like -245 or something. That's just one number. Yeah, it's a single scalar number, and the size of the scalar number is here depicted in terms of this bar. Now the log marginal likelihood decomposition that we have seen and also proven just before the break means that you can write this log marginal likelihood in terms of two numbers, namely a Kell divergence between a variational distribution and the variational free energy. Yeah, so there are two parts of this. Thank you. There are two parts of this, namely this variational free energy and this Kell divergence. Yeah. And now one thing that is quite important and that we will look at first is the KL divergence, its intuition, and also the important aspect that the KL divergence is always larger or equal to zero. So, KL divergence. The KL divergence in general for two probability density functions is defined as this, as we've seen also previously when I wrote it up. So for when we looked at it in the terms of variational inference, we had here the variational distribution, which was also denoted by Q, and the posterior distribution, which was P bar theta given y. Here it's just another distribution over x. Yeah, so this is the general definition of the KL divergence. This is an integral, so you put in two probability density functions, and then you have to evaluate this integral. And as an example of two probability density functions, you could think of putting in two normal, univariate normal probability density function. Yeah, so you have a normal density nx mu q sigma squared q. So you have a Gaussian, univariate Gaussian distribution, so the thing that you know from undergrad statistics, with expectation parameter mu q and variance parameter sigma square q, and you have another probability density function with expectation mu p and variance parameter sigma square p. Now, for this, you can evaluate this integral analytically, which we will not do here, but you can just into this integral substitute the probability density functions and then solve the integral. And the result will be what you see on this side. And the question is, what do we see? Well, we see that a big contribution, or a contribution to the KL divergence between two univariate Gaussians, is the difference in their means. This means if the means of the two Gaussian distributions, the KL divergence, as I said, which is a measure of the distance or the difference between those, gets big, and also the variance variance parameters play a role. I think it's easier to appreciate that just by an example, and this is shown here. So as I said, we are dealing with so we are dealing with two univariate Gaussians, so which you see here, for example, yeah? And we have one that is centered here on zero, and it's depicted in blue. So this is our first Gaussian distribution with parameters mu q and sigma square q, and the parameters for mu q are zero, so the expectation is at zero, and the variance parameter sigma square q is at is one, I guess. Yeah, I think it's one. So this is the first one. Now the question is, how different, or what's the distance from this blue probability density function to the red one? The red one is the one denoted by mu p and sigma square p, and obviously in this case it has a higher expectation parameter. The expectation is 1.6, so it's located here, and it has a slightly lower variance. I'm actually not quite sure. I chose it because I wanted some little bit deviation also here. It has a smaller variance sigma square p. Yeah. And here Both of them are fairly similar, so this is why you only basically see one here. And there's a little bit of a deviation, which you can appreciate if you look closely here. But here the p is only, the expectation is only minus 0.02, and the variance is only slightly smaller than for q. Now the question is, how does the KL divergence between these two look? So this is what is plotted here. So this is the KL divergence between Px, which is the one with the expectation parameter 0 and the variance parameter 1, to Qx. Px is the one that is shown here in red, and Qx is the one that is blue and centered here on zero. Yeah, so Qx is the reference. So the thing is, this is with respect to the reference of an expectation parameter of zero and variance parameter of one. Now, if we look at this case, they are fairly similar, and we have for p we have 0, and for variance we almost have 1. So the distance to qx, that means the parameters 0 and 1, is fairly low. Now, if we increase the expectation of the second expectation parameter of the Px distribution have roughly the same variance, the distance measure is quite large. So you can see here the KL divergence with respect to the distribution for centered at zero and with variance one is quite large. So we have here a KL divergence of, well, let's say 1.5 or so, where here we are, we're almost at zero. It's so this shift in means, what this basically shows is that this shift in mean contributes a lot to the distance. And here we have the case where the means are essentially identical and the variance is different. Yeah, so you see that our distribution Q is still the same. It's 0 and 1 for expectation and variance, and now the variance of the second distribution, so the p distribution, is larger. The expectation is roughly the same, and you see there's also an increase in the KL divergence. It's a little bit easier to see actually in the handout, because there is kind of a valley down here, and here we're slightly above that valley. But definitely the changing the mean for these two Gaussian univariate Gaussians has a bigger effect on the KL divergence. Yeah? Yep.
Now, I describe it looks like that with a higher variance, that the distance would be smaller. The KL divergence is bigger at 0.5, it goes high up. And at 0.2, at a variance of 2, it looks like it's smaller. It only goes up to 1.
It's a little bit hard to see actually. So if you look into the script or at the digital figure, you see that this is actually lower. One cannot see that here on the projection. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yes. For the mean of 0, I see that, the 2 points. But if you look at the mean of, or the how do you call it?
You mean this?
Yes, I mean on the outer boundaries of 2 and minus 2, it looks like that if for a smaller variance, the Kuhn-Bock-Leibler divergence is higher than for a high variance of 2, which I don't
understand. Yeah, no, that's actually a good point, good observation, which I also haven't thought about much, but so assuming that everything is correct, then I think, so what you are referring to is the case that the means are quite different. So we have one thing here and one thing here. Yeah?
Yes.
And then I actually can, so what you are describing is that the difference gets larger for small variants. And I would say that this makes intuitive sense, because if you think of this case, let's say this is small variants, and here you have the case of large variants, then I would also intuitively say that this case with these distributions, the difference is larger, smaller variance, but a larger distance than the case with here the large variance, because here they then overlap a little bit. So it makes sense from my perspective. Yeah, no, very good observation. Actually, I haven't really thought about this. So the point is, and this is also what I recently discussed with Arthur Jacobs, these are distance functions. So they are supposed to, the chiral divergence is supposed to capture the fact that two distributions are different and that you can allocate a number to how different they are. And there are different ways one can do that. So one thing that you might know in terms of Euclidean space is that you can compute the Euclidean distance between two points. I mean, if you did anything technical in Radek's and Daniel Kaiser's course, I hope you covered Euclidean distance. Did that come up as a distance of patterns in the brain? No. In 1D, I mean, Euclidean distance is just what you know from Pythagoras, lots of Pythagoras. So if you in 2D compute the distance between two points in 2D, then that's the Euclidean distance. So there are many distance functions for different things. This would be points in 2D. Here we are dealing with a distance function for probability density functions. It's by all means not the only distance functions that you can use, and specifically it's also not a metric in the metric sense. So a metric in the metric sense is that it's so what are the metric things? So it needs to be transitive, so x, so the distance between x and y needs to be the same as y and x. It needs to fulfill the triangle inequality. So if you go from x to y, that's a shorter distance than if you go from x to z, and then from z to y, that's the triangle inequality. And then there's the first thing, it's the first property of a metric. I think it's that it's larger or equal to zero, I guess. Not quite sure right now, but that's a very basic mathematical formulation of the notion of a distance. For what we need, and what is really important for also variational inference, are two properties of the chiral divergence, namely. The first property that the chiral divergence is always larger or equal to zero for all probabilities. That means it's always positive or zero. Yeah? So the difference or the distance or the dissimilarity between two probability density functions is either zero, and it's supposed to be zero only for the case that the two densities are identical. So if they have the same parameters, if they are identical, then the distance is supposed to be zero. That makes sense. So if you have two things that are the same, then their measure of dissimilarity should be zero. If they are dissimilar, then the difference should be larger than zero. Yeah? So you cannot have negative chiral divergences. That's very important. One can actually show this non-negativity, and this is an intuitive proof of this non-negativity, but I recommend I would say that it's more helpful if you look at this on your own, because to discuss it, we would have to introduce convex functions now, and then it's also more like an intuitive proof that shows works a lot on intuition. So it's helpful if you feel like you want to understand a little bit more why the KL divergence is always positive or zero, but looking into the proof doesn't change the fact that the KL divergence for two densities is always positive or zero if they are the same. Yeah, so that's the crucial thing. It's not a metric in the mathematical sense. You get a metric in the mathematical sense from the KL divergence if you, instead of looking at KL PX QX, add to it KL. So the other way around. So if you add to the KL divergence between QX and PX, you add the KL divergence of PX versus QX, then it's a metric because on its own the KL divergence is not symmetric. So the distance between QX and PX is not the same as the distance between PX and QX for the KL divergence. Hence, it's not a metric, but you can get a metric from it by adding to it the reverse and KL divergence. So this that it's not symmetric, you can also in a way appreciate here by the fact that here there's only this sigma squared p, which means that sigma squared p here does a little bit more than sigma squared q. Yeah. So the most important thing about the KL divergence is that it's non-negative, it's always larger or equal to zero, and it's zero in the case that the two densities which are subjected to it are identical. Yeah. So that's important. Questions about this? No. Good. So how can this now be used for variational inference? Well, the point is that the KL divergence is always larger or equal to zero. Yeah? And so there are two things that are really important. First, the property of the KL divergence is larger or equal to zero, and the fact that the log model evidence, this thing here is fixed. Yeah, so this is fixed for a given data observation. This is a fixed number, and this fixed number has two contributions: the KL divergence and the variational free energy. Now, the KL divergence is between the variational distribution and the true posterior distribution. Now think that for the variational distribution, we would put in the true posterior distribution. What do we get for the KL divergence term? So if we for q var theta, we put in p var theta given y? Zero, yeah. And that would mean that this part here of this long bar goes to zero, which would then imply that this variational free energy, if we put in for q bar theta, p bar theta given y, is completely identical, or is just identical to the log marginal likelihood. In the case that we are not we don't have the variational distribution being identical to the posterior distribution, there is a contribution of the KL divergence to this log marginal likelihood. Now, the principle of variational inference is, and you can view that from two perspectives, is to use the fact that this is always larger or equal to zero, which implies that the variational free energy is always smaller or equal to the log marginal likelihood. Yeah? So because it's always the case that this bar decomposes into this and this. And then this here can be zero. Then the variation free energy is identical to the log marginal likelihood, or the KL divergence contribution is larger than zero, then of course the variation free energy contribution is smaller. Yeah? So it's always smaller or equal to the log marginal likelihood. And then the fundamental idea of variational inference is to either, so you can view it both in both ways, to either minimize this KL divergence by trying to get the variational distribution closer to the true posterior distribution, which if you minimize this, which would mean that the contribution of the variational free energy gets larger, so this bar gets, so this vertical bar here gets moved there, or to do it the other way around, to instead of minimizing the KL divergence, maximizing the variational free energy contribution, so the variational free energy as a function of the variational distribution, and maximizing this, which has the same effect on the KL divergence, because this distance here, so this bar is fixed, this cannot be changed. If you increase this contribution to that, then the KL divergence must get smaller. And if the KL divergence gets smaller, this means that the variational distribution needs to become closer to the posterior distribution, because it's a measure of their distance. Yeah? So the fundamental aim of variational inference then is to approximate the posterior distribution by minimizing the dissimilarity between the variational distribution and the true posterior distribution, either by manipulating the KL divergence directly, but, and this is usually how it works in most applications, by maximizing the variation of free energy. Yeah. So by changing the input to the variational free energy, namely this this variational distribution, to increase its value and to increase it as much as possible. If it doesn't increase anymore, however this is done, then this is kind of the endpoint of variational inference, and then what is being used is that the converged variational free energy is used as the approximation for the log model evidence, which we cannot compute directly, and the converged, so I maybe do a little star here because that's not the first your first guess, but that's after you tried your best to increase the variational free energy. This is used as approximation to the posterior. Yeah. And yeah. So questions right now about this?
So I'm adjusting the parameters of the variational density, in a way so that the KL is the smallest possible, right?
Yeah.
And in order to calculate the KL, then the divergence, I need to have parameters for the posterior density. Mm-hmm. Where do I get this?
That's a very good question. Yeah, and this is actually one of the main motivations to maximize the free energy, because there you don't need the posterior parameters. And you need, however, for the variation of free energy, you need the joint. Yeah? And the joint you have because you defined it. So the joint distribution you get from the prior distribution and the data likelihood, both of which you define, because you define your prior and you define your likelihood. And then you need this joint distribution in the definition of the free energy. And you're completely right to do KL divergence minimization in this setting. You already need the posterior distribution. This is why this is usually not working and usually not done. It's sometimes done for demonstrative purposes or in cases where you do some other approximations of the posterior and so on. So it exists, but definitely the much the scenario that is that I'm much more familiar with and that is much more being used also is that you maximize the free energy where you have everything that you need. So you have the P from by definition, and the Q, depending on which form of that depends a little bit which form of variation inference you use, but you also have something on Q to work with. Very good question. So to give you a bit more of an intuition on this kind of algorithmic approach of maximizing the free energy, it's helpful to introduce what is called a mean field approximation, because only then one can see this, algorithmic aspect a little bit better. So, a mean field approximation for the variational distribution is just a factorization. So it's called, again, there's this it's left over from physics, this term mean field. The thing is, usually these var thetas are or thetas are not only one. So not only one random variable, but multiple, for example, two. And then an assumption that is often used in variational inference to simplify it is to assume, for example, if you have, let's say you have two parameters, let's call them lambda and mu, to assume for the variational distribution that this joint distribution over lambda and mu factorizes into two distributions, one over lambda and one over mu. And if you want to have the probability density for a value of lambda and a value of mu, then you just need to multiply the probability density you get from this distribution and from this distribution. This kind of factorization assumption is called mean field assumption, just fancy word. But how can it be used? And this is what this shows. So we're assuming actually a factorization into a partition of random variables S and those not S. So for the so that could be, if there are only two, this would be lambda and this would be mu, or x1 and x2. If there are more, so if there's lambda, gamma, and mu, then this would be, for example, lambda, and this would be gamma. The important thing that I want to show you on this is the figure. Yeah, and because this shows the algorithmic approach. So now f is a function of variational distribution, and the variational distribution now factors into a couple of individual variational distributions, and then you can do a coordinate wise ascent of the variational free energy. What I mainly want to show you here is that you start here with a variational distribution over S and a variational distribution over those variables not in S, and then you update this variational distribution, and because you update it to maximize the variational free energy, this part of the variational free energy gets larger, which means that the KL divergence between the entire variational distribution and the posterior distribution gets smaller. And what I just want to show you is that this bar shifts from here to here. So that's the main point. Now, this whole thing, in terms of maximizing this variation free energy, for example, by this coordinate wise ascent, maybe also by computing the posterior distribution. So this whole idea that we discussed here is, of course, fairly general. Yeah. So, of course, it depends how an exact algorithm where you use this depends a lot on your probabilistic model, so on your distribution p, y, and bar theta, and on what kind of form of variational inference you want to use, whether you want to basically have the variational distributions fall out of the whole framework, which is called free-form variational inference, or whether you assume a certain form of variational distributions, which is called fixed-form variational inference. And then things look completely different, and you have very different problems to solve. So this is, if you feel it's a little bit esoteric at this point, it is because it's very general. But it's a general principle that you can apply in any form of probabilistic model. And I don't think I want to start with going into free form or fixed form mean field variation inference today, because that's a real topic, both of which are real topics on their own. So I rather would ask you if you have some questions. Have you come across free energy principle in any paper?
No.
You just come across B1 and scene recognition. Tables and chairs. Share on the table. Prediction error. No, but we don't say prediction error because we're among his peers and we. That would be too much. So free energy principle is essentially saying that the brain uses variational base, so maximizing the variational free energy in order to approximate this quantity. Yeah, but I don't really want to go into free energy principle now because it's there are many things that would need to be discussed then. So sometimes you find, maybe that's one thing to know, in terms of the free energy principle, you always find minimizing surprise and minimizing free energy. The trick is just to have the definition of the free energy with a minus in front. So I'm always talking about maximizing the variation of free energy because, as we will see, the free energy function in probabilistic models is exactly the same, has exactly the same role as the likelihood function. So if you maximize a likelihood function with respect to its parameters, you have some kind of objective function and you use this to get some parameter estimates. The same thing is what you do with the free energy function. You maximize it to get either parameters or directly your variational distributions. So in my world, we maximize the variational free energy function because it's called maximum likelihood. Yeah, it's not called minimum negative likelihood. Hence, we don't do minimizing the negative free energy. but we do maximizing the free energy as we do maximizing the likelihood function. Unfortunately, if you do this numerically and you have your standard tools to do numerical optimization, these are always formulated in terms of minimization. So if you do maximum likelihood with some tools like SciPy or MATLAB, you will actually always do minimum negative likelihood. But still, the principle is called maximum likelihood and not minimum negative likelihood principle, and hence maximizing free energy and not minimizing negative free energy in my world. Okay, so if there are no questions, then we stop here and take our Pentecost break next week for statistical methods. And then continue the week after with these two notions of mean field and with these two notions of free form mean field variational inference versus fixed form mean field variational inference. Good, then stop here.